together, this is going to be an exciting week as we recognize that we will celebrate the arrival of our Savior in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. And so that's going to be happening on Thursday. So our first announcement this morning is our Christmas Eve services. If you still haven't signed up, we've asked people to sign up because of social distancing requirements and things like that. So if you haven't signed up and you'd like to join us for worship, there is still room at the 10 o'clock service, right? There is still room. We are not going to be the inn in Bethlehem. We're going to make sure there is room. So if you'd still like to join us, there's a sign-up sheet out there on the Welcome Center. For those of you at home, if you'd like to come, just simply send an email. Or also on the website, there's an opportunity to sign up there. Also, just to let you know, as we look forward a little bit to Christmas Day service and so forth, the Christmas Day service will be at 9 a.m., and the New Year's Eve service, that's the following week, will be in the evening. For those of you that really want to see 2020 leave, we're going to celebrate that, right? And so if you'd like to join us for that as well, a great opportunity for us to get together and worship the Lord. Thank Him, believe it or not, for the year 2020. We're still together, and God is still on the throne. Let's celebrate being together as church. Would you rise up right now? Would you greet one another with a wave and a smile, remind them that God loves them? And for those of you online, greet one another again with a little comment under the video. Let's remain standing as we sing our first hymn.
He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
sinful people in desperate need of redemption, and we cannot do it on our own. In fact, we can't do it at all. And so we come before God, seeking His mercy, asking for His grace, and receiving the blessing that comes with that. So I'm going to ask us as we gather together, for those of you that are gathering at home, let's take up the posture of a repentant people. I want to invite you, if you'd like, to slide forward where you're seated, perhaps holding your hands over the seat in front of you. Let's speak these words of confession you'll find in your bulletin or up on the screen. We confess together. Please hear my confession, O God. I, a poor sinner, plead guilty before you of all sins. I have lived as if you did not matter, and as if I mattered most. Your name I have not honored as I should. My worship and prayers have faltered. I have not let your love have its way with me, and so my love for others has failed. There are those whom I have hurt, and those whom I have failed to help. My thoughts and desires have been spoiled to sin. Forgive my sin, O God, for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus.
And so God has indeed heard our confession. And when we are transparent before God, allowing Him to seek our hearts, that's where you can clean out all of that sin that we allow to take up residence. And so Jesus came to do what we could not do. He lived a perfect life. He died an innocent death. And He rose victorious from the grave to proclaim once and for all that sin is no more, that death is not the end, and the power of Satan is forever broken. And so as God's spokesman to you today, I announce to you with great joy and absolute conviction in the promise and provision of the Word of God that your sin, my sin, all of it, is completely forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit back for our first readings.
Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel in the preaching of Jesus Christ, be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary said to the angel, how will this be, since I am a virgin? The angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Thank you.
measure of understanding, of zeal and courage that comes from your Spirit alone. Lord, may we recognize that we are to be vessels of your Spirit, that we are to be an extension of your hands and feet, and be mouthpieces. Lord, too often we take things on and say, I think this is what is best, and this is what is good. Lord, empty us of ourselves, and Lord, may we look to you, may we seek you, and as you promised, may we find you to fill us as we are your church. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. God's grace, God's mercy, and God's peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to direct your attention, as I always do, to the bulletin. There's an outline in there if you'd like to follow along. If you're watching us online, it's located on our website, and you can pull it up. It has the weekly bulletin there. The outline is there. Bonus for you, it's already filled in, right? And so, yeah, you all got to work a little bit this morning, right? Underneath the outline, as always, there are a series of Bible readings there. And that's really my encouragement to you to be in the Word of God each day. We also post those, by the way. Somebody was asking about this. We post those on Facebook. Every day they come out, the read and reflect. So if you didn't know that, if you're on our Facebook page, get that feed. That's why that's popping up. That's our read and reflect verses for the day. And those verses follow what we talked about this morning. They're not just random. Not that the random Word of God wouldn't be a blessing. But it does take what we talked about this morning and kind of fills it in a little bit more. Back in the 1830s, two British inventors created the telegraph for the sole purpose of transmitting messages over great distances. With the assistance of a guy by the name of Samuel Morse, who created a code by that same name, they were able to pass information quickly across continents. But because dialogue wasn't really practical, and because the necessity to keep these messages brief, people were often anxious when they received a telegram, because it often communicated a death had occurred, an accident had happened, a sickness had spread, or a war had begun. Tragic news in short phrases is hard to receive. So in 1933, a guy by the name of George Olson from Western Union began to offer singing telegrams as a way to make receiving messages more enjoyable and maybe even fun. Now, God didn't see fit to send the announcement of his son entering into this world by singing a telegram, simply because it didn't need any dressing up. It was the greatest announcement in history. But it did come and was communicated by one of his archangels, Gabriel, in dramatic fashion, to be sure. The announcement of Gabriel to the ears of a young maiden in a small, out-of-the-way town was God's gift to the world. And it's just like God to extend this call to a waiting world from the place and person and circumstance that we heard from in Luke's gospel that Mark read just minutes ago. If you'd like to follow along this morning in our gospel reading, if you'd like to take out a Bible out of the pew rack, I'm going to invite you to open up to Luke chapter 1. It's on page 1016, and Luke 1 is our passage. And I'd like to highlight three observations from the announcement of Gabriel that doesn't only teach us, but I believe can impact us right now today. And so the first observation I'd like to draw our attention to is that God chooses the place. See, God chooses the place where the Messiah is going to enter into this world. And as is often the case, God chooses unconventional instead of what the world expects. And in our gospel, the announcement of John to Zechariah and Elizabeth demonstrate that as well. Verse 26 of Luke 1, earlier than our reading. It says, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. So Nazareth, at this time, would have had a population of around 300 or 400 people. And this is where the angel Gabriel is going to announce the long-awaited They probably followed God's rules a little bit closer, because Nazareth was this out in the country kind of place. It was remote. It wasn't near any trade routes. In fact, it wasn't near anything important at all. And the long-standing opinion of Nazareth is actually pointed out as Jesus later on in his adult life begins calling disciples. Let me just pick up John chapter 1, beginning verse 45, as he connects with Philip and Nathanael. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Now earlier in Luke 1, Gabriel did make a visit to the temple in Jerusalem, if you recall, to tell the priest Zechariah the news of a son who would prepare the way for the Messiah. So in the end, the angel Gabriel was sent to both places because all real estate is equal to God. And there's some truth in that for us, but more on that in a minute. Then it goes on, Gabriel relays the message that God even has a very specific place for the Messiah to enter. In Luke chapter 1, verse 27, it says, "To a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary." And so the very specific place that the Messiah will enter into this world is the womb of a virgin. And Luke is actually reminding us in that this is a sign of the Messiah. Several centuries early, the prophet Isaiah said these words in Isaiah 7, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign." Watch for this. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." And then Gabriel continues his announcement, jumping up to Luke 1. "And he came to her and said, 'Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you.'" Still shocked, certainly, by the appearance of an angel, this powerful news of the angel says, "The Lord is with you." Now, Mary, as well as Luke's hearers, would understand this presence of God. It's been described many times before. In fact, in Judges chapter 6 in the Old Testament, a story about Gideon is one of the many examples. It says, "And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, 'The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor.'" You see, every place changes when God shows up. Every town, every person, and even the womb of a virgin. This child, according to the prophet Isaiah, would be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. So the second observation this morning in Gabriel's announcement to Mary is that God grants his presence. Mary's womb was to be the real estate that God would claim as the place for the Messiah's entry into the world. Verses 29 through 33, listen to these words again. "But she," that's Mary, "was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end.'" His name will be Jesus. That means the Lord saves. What a promise. Mary will provide the place for Emmanuel, God with us, and will name him Jesus, the Lord saves. But in this promise of immaculate conception, Mary can't create the Messiah. That's why we believe God chose a virgin. See, it's only through God's presence that the creative act can be accomplished. In fact, I find that a beautiful picture of the gospel. Because humans on their own cannot produce their own salvation. Only God can. Only God has chosen to accomplish it for all of humanity from Nazareth, from a womb of a virgin. And so Mary provides herself, and God does the rest. In fact, in Luke 1:34, it says, "And Mary said to the angel, 'How will this be, since I am a virgin?'" This is not a statement of unbelief like Zechariah. A couple weeks ago we talked about that. But rather, this is a question for Mary. I want you to know, church, God welcomes questions. Especially those that cause us to seek and lean into Him. Mary was going to have to trust God with the details. And so Mary provides herself as the real estate to be claimed, to be developed, and to be turned into the place for the fulfillment of the promise of God to save the world. And Gabriel's explanation is powerful. In verse 35, it says, "And the angel answered her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, Son of God.'" Now clearly, the angelic announcement will be wrapped up in the activity and work of the Holy Spirit. That's what the word overshadow means. In Greek, it's episkiazo. And Luke's hearers, again, would have been familiar with this word. In fact, as the Israelites wandered through the desert, in Exodus chapter 40, it says, "Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple," episkiazo. "And Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled on it, and the glory of the Lord," episkiazo, "filled the tabernacle." And here the angel announces that the glory of the Lord is present with Mary. His Spirit provides not only the miraculous creation in a virgin conception, but also God's protection. You see, whenever God's presence rests on someone or some place, it is active and it is creative. Always. In fact, let's go all the way back to the very first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, the second verse. "And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep." And then what happens? The Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And I understand we probably all know what happened next. And so this same Spirit of God rests upon Mary, enabling her to do and be more than she could ever by herself. God's call to Mary was to surrender, and God will work out the details. Now I want you to imagine for a moment what must have been running through Mary's mind at this announcement that the long-awaited Messiah is finally here. And that she was thinking that I am blessed to be the one to provide the means in which he will enter this world. Who on earth can I talk to? She could talk to her betrothed, Joseph. But how can he possibly understand? Listen to verse 36. Why does Gabriel add this? "And behold, your relative, Elizabeth, in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called Mary." This brings me to the third observation of Gabriel's announcement. God never leaves us alone. Consider for a moment Mary's cousin, Elizabeth. She too had received an announcement by way of her husband Zechariah's sign language. From Gabriel delivered it to him as well, that they too would have a son that would be a crucial part of God's plan of salvation. And the circumstances of their conception was miraculous as well. But that's where the similarities between Mary and Elizabeth end. You see, where John would be the messenger, Jesus would be the Messiah. And where Elizabeth's conception albeit unlikely in her old age, Mary conceived as a virgin, but with the mysterious and powerful presence of God. And where Zechariah doubted Gabriel's message when he was acting as priest, Mary simply acknowledged that she was a servant of God.
And then probably some of the most powerful words of this heavenly messenger, verse 37, "For nothing will be impossible with God." Church, nothing is impossible for God. You see, because God chose an out-of-the-way town of Nazareth to select the place where the Messiah would enter into this world, the womb of a virgin named Mary. Impossible? Nothing is impossible for God. Never is. That's what this message of the angel today is to remind us. That nothing is impossible when the Savior is on the scene. And so what does this mean for us today? I want you to think right now. I want you to consider your impossible for God. Is it a situation at work? Maybe for our younger folks, is it at school? Is it an impossible situation with your finances? With your marriage? Strained relationship with one of your kids or perhaps a neighbor? Do you have a slate of responsibilities that feels crippling and consuming? Do you have a never-ending debt? I want you to consider those same three observations this morning from God's messenger to Mary. First again is this: God invites you to provide real estate. Not a womb. The Messiah has already been born. But he does want to reside in your heart. And he wants to claim it. He wants to develop it. And he wants to turn it into a place for the fulfillment of his promise to make an eternal difference in this world. And God promises his presence. He says, "My presence will overshadow you so that he can do in you and through you what you cannot do." Now remember, the presence of God always changes the place where it takes up residence. And so expect that. And so that change might be unbelievable. It might be painful. And it almost always calls for sacrifice. But God can do the incredible, because nothing is impossible for God. And the last observation is simply this: you're never alone. Not only is our Messiah called Emmanuel, which means God with us, is that himself, he wants to multiply himself by his Spirit through the people of God. And so there will likely be Elizabeths to walk alongside of you in this faith walk, in this sharing their experience and their wisdom with you. See, church, when you let Jesus not only take up residence, but live day by day in your heart, it will change everything. In fact, it will change your eternity. And with Christ in you, you and I will be God's gift to this world. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. In a few moments following our prayers, we're going to come forward and receive the very presence of God. I would ask that as you come forward, I would ask that you would bring your tithes and your offerings with you to place here in our prayer well at the head of the aisle. For those of you tuning in from home, if you would like to send those in, way of the mail, or if you'd like to drop them by if you're local here in town, please do so. We recognize that God continues to challenge us through our offerings and our tithes to trust him more completely with everything that we have and everything that we are. I'd also want to invite you to fill
cards and those yellow cards that's in the pew rack there. If you have any information you'd like to share with us or any prayer requests that you have in your life right now, just know that those will come to me, and I'll be glad to be able to join you in prayer with whatever needs or praises that we want to speak to God on your behalf. If you're a guest with us today, thank you for joining us, and I would ask that you grab one of those purple cards out of the pew rack. Take it home with you. And on that purple card, there might be some information that you find helpful, and it might connect some dots for you. And so please grab one of those things we do again, and maybe that will prove something helpful for you as well. In our prayers, following each of the petitions that we will pray for, I will speak and pray, Lord, in your mercy. And I would invite you to respond here, our prayer. One of the prayers we're going to add in our bulletin, I want to make sure that you are aware of it, is that our brother John Funk did indeed pass away earlier this week. And there are no funeral arrangements at this time, mostly because of concerns of COVID and gathering and things like that. But we will make sure we keep you abreast of how we as a church can continue to grieve and also thank God for the gift that John was and continues to be to this church. Would you please stand? Let us go before the Lord in prayer. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for the gift and power of your Son, Jesus, who comes to us as the greatest of all gifts, the final gift. And yet, Lord, we often look past that gift and think about what we enjoy, what we pursue, and what we chase after in this world. So, Lord, you granted us the greatest of gifts, not just the gift of salvation, but the gift of your Spirit. And, Lord, I pray that that Spirit would grow in us, would fan the flame of faith so that we all, as your church, can be the gift to this world. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I pray for those that are on our hearts today, for those that are needing physical healing and emotional and relational help, and Lord, that you would encourage them and gird them up through these prayers of your people. And so, Lord, I pray today for Nancy, for Bernice, for Regina, for Paul, and Gene and Quinetta, for JR, Lord, that you would grant them your help and healing and strength at this time, and if it is your will, bring them to full healing. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I pray for the family and friends of John. Lord, as we mourn his passing, Lord, in the midst of our sadness and sorrow, there is hope. And not a small hope, not an emotional hope, but hope in the one, the King, Christ, who walked out of his own tomb, and because of that opens the way of eternal life. So that for us, we trust and know and believe that death is not the end, that those that trust and lean on you, Lord, we all look forward to that reunion in heaven one day, and we will see John again. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we celebrate with Matt and Annie Skelton on the birth of a new little baby, Solomon Gabriel. Lord, we celebrate the birth and the joy of new life, and we thank you for good health for Annie and little Solomon. We pray that you continue to grow them together as a family. Lord, we look forward to the day soon when little Solomon will be added to your family through the gift of Holy Communion, Holy Baptism. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, I pray for our country. That you continue to soothe and comfort it, not in a way of ease, but in truth. And Lord, that we would boldly speak what is right and what is wrong according to your word, not our flesh. And Lord, that you would use leaders to continue to point us in a direction that encourages and blesses the peace that you intend in this world. And so Lord, through the voice of your people, your church, Lord, that we would continue to alleviate the tensions among races and countries and groups and people. Lord, that we would continue to seek out your peace in this world. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Finally, Lord, I pray for those that watch over and protect us. So I pray for those that serve honor them at all times and to thank them when opportunity presents itself. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father, all these things, I ask in the name of Jesus, who has also taught us to pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. As we pointed out, God will choose any real estate to come to and to bless us, and this meal is no exception. For Christ takes every day bread and wine and visits us, and through that encourages us to be gifts ourselves to this world. Let us prepare our hearts now for the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, whose way John the Baptist prepared, proclaiming him the promised Messiah, the very Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and calling sinners to repentance, they might escape from the wrath to be revealed when he comes again in glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Thank you.
congregation, please stand. Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you to life everlasting. Receive now the blessing of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Thank you.